Are we ready to go? So I know we're going to have a few more people wandering in from the other building, but if we start on time, we get cocktails on time. So since that's more important than accommodating the laggards, why don't we get started? So I am absolutely delighted to have been invited to moderate this particular timely panel on tax reform. I call it timely because after a period of more than 30 years since the last major tax reform package was passed, we appear to be only a month or so away from a major new bill from the House Ways and Means Committee. And meanwhile, public debate over key features of the likely bill have been relatively active over the last few months. The two topics that seem to be getting the most attention are corporate tax reform and the political dynamics of passing tax reform in the presence of a House and Senate that don't see entirely eye to eye on many of the likely provisions, and an Oval Office that's marching to still a different drumbeat. So said differently, there's remarkable agreement among Ryan, Brady, and Trump over tax rates, both personal and corporate, but there's substantial disagreement over how to pay for it and the desirability of border-adjusted taxes. So is passage of a major bill likely? We'll certainly touch on that. But I'd observe that the US stock market's up over 10% over the first 4 months since the elections took place. And some of that rally is undoubtedly a reflection of at least an expectation of faster economic growth in the US economy resulting from policy changes being touted by the president and by Congress. Now, tax policy for me has been an enjoyable hobby for the last 40 years. And I've done some publishing in the area, and I've done some teaching in the area. But I plan during this panel to defer to the true experts, which I would distinguish myself from. And I am particularly pleased to note that we've got exactly the right two people for this panel today. So Ellen Auerbach is arguably today's leading academic policy voice on corporate tax reform. I've followed and admired Ellen's work for more than 30 years now. And since completing his PhD at Harvard in the late 70s, he's had faculty appointments and served as department chair at both Penn and UC Berkeley, and he's also served on the faculty at Harvard. And he's also served as Deputy Chief of Staff of the U.S. Joint Committee on Taxation. He's also served as a consultant to several government agencies and institutions in the U.S. and abroad. He's won all kinds of research awards. He's been named a fellow of both the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the Econometric Society. He served as vice president of the American Economic Association, president of the National Tax Association, and he's been a research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research for, gosh, I don't know, 40 years?
Can't be that.
Alan's a chaired professor at UC Berkeley. He also runs the public finance and tax policy program, the Burch Center at UC Berkeley. And perhaps most importantly, he's just an uncommonly clear-headed thinker, an innovative mind in the tax policy arena, and he's just an awfully nice guy to boot. Keith Hennessey is a relative newbie to the Stanford campus, only six years and counting. We're thrilled to have him on the campus. He lectures in economics and is one of the most popular teachers at the Stanford Business School. Prior to joining the Stanford faculty, he was a consummate Washington insider. He spent almost 15 years in economic policy advisory roles, advising a number of elected officials, including Senators Trent Lott and Pete Domenici, as well as 6 years helping to advise President George W. Bush with economic policy. He served as both deputy director and then director of the White House National Economic Council, where he coordinated policy design and implementation for the president. And no stranger to tax legislation, Keith helped President Bush cut taxes. He helped him create a health savings accounts. And he spent more than a year advising the president and his administration on the response to the financial crisis, along with implementation of TARP and other financial rescue measures. There are others in this audience that he certainly worked with during that period of time. I don't know, I see John Taylor in the back of the room. I don't know if Eddie Lazier is around, but I know, Keith, you spent a lot of time with Eddie during those years. He has helped design, enact, and implement more policy and regulatory reform issues than I really have time to enumerate, but they range all over the place, from tax reform to health reform to Social Security to climate change, safety standards in the auto industry, broadband issues, housing reforms, including reforms of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. Keith likes to kid, although I think it's pretty accurate, that both Democrats and Republicans alike have him to thank for his role in coordinating the most popular domestic policy of the Bush presidency, the do not call list that prohibits telemarketers from calling you at dinner time.
I don't get full credit. I played a small part in it.
A small part. Well, I still have a bone to pick. They still call me sometimes. So. Keith has a couple of Stanford degrees and a public policy degree from Harvard. And again, this combination of the guru of corporate tax reform and a really experienced in the trenches guy who spent time on tax legislation is the perfect cocktail for this particular session. So here's my plan. I'm going to ask Alan to begin with a high-level description of the problems with and potential solutions to the current U.S. corporate tax system. Then we'll switch to Keith, and we'll ask Keith to describe the challenges associated with legislating tax reform. And then I'll follow those introductory remarks with a couple of questions for each of them to help us drill down a bit. And your job is to take notes as we go, because once we've done that, we'll make sure we turn it over to you to take it in whatever additional directions you think might be appropriate. So as I ask Alan to start us off, I'm reminded of Steve Hadley's post-lunch remarks, where he described policy people as experts who are paid to be optimistic, which I think, in light of the challenges in passing this legislation, is probably an appropriate label. But let me add, there's a lot at stake here, and I think Alan has a lot of convincing perspectives to share on this particular subject.
Thank you very much, Mark. It's great to be here. I thought, since this is an academic institution, I would start with a quiz. I think John Chauvin probably knows the answer to this question, but by market capitalization, what was the largest U.S. company in the mid-60s? No?
IBM?
I haven't heard it yet. It was AT&T.
AT&T, okay.
And it, you know, not the current AT&T, of course, Ma Bell. In 50 years later, the three of the top five companies by market cap were Alphabet, Microsoft, and Apple. They weren't up there in the mid-60s. That is a good indicator of the change in the corporate sector in the last 50 years and a window into the problems of our current corporate tax system. Over that period, the share of intellectual property assets by value doubled as a share of business assets. The share of earnings of U.S. companies that come from abroad quadrupled during that period. So we've had a rise in the multinational company as an important factor in the U.S. corporate sector. We've had a big increase in the importance of intellectual property as a productive asset. Now, why do those two things matter as we think about the design of our corporate tax system? We have a corporate tax system that relies very heavily on concepts of corporate residence that is where companies reside, and the source of profit, that is where they earn their money. And the rise of the multinational means that corporate residence isn't quite as well defined as it used to be, because you have companies, whether they are called U.S. companies or called German or other nationality companies, have big operations in the U.S. and big operations in other countries. And residence is not as well defined, and it isn't as permanent in terms of the characteristic of a company as it once was. The importance of intellectual property combined with the importance of multinationals with operations around the globe makes it much more difficult to identify where profits are being earned. If you're a company only producing in one country, it's pretty clear where you're making money, even if you're exporting. If you're producing in many countries, it's more difficult to identify where you're earning your profit, and it's particularly difficult to identify if you're using intellectual property in production. Because we can say where a factory is, it's pretty hard to say where a patent is. I mean, of course, we have patent law, it may be registered in a particular company, but there's no location for intellectual property. It's just there. And this makes a tax system, these changing factors make a tax system that relies very heavily on definition of corporate residence and an assumption that you can identify where profits are earned quite problematic. So with that background, think about the current U.S. tax system and the distortions that it causes. We have the highest tax rate in the world, 35%. And we attempt to tax earnings made in the United States. That's sort of based on the source of income. And we also, quite unlike most other countries, try to tax earnings that U.S. companies earn offshore, at least to the extent that they repatriate the earnings. And these lead to a variety of problems. The taxing of, first of all, having a high tax rate makes whatever problems exist worse, because the U.S. tax rate leads to responses. And what are those responses? Well, the attempt to tax based on earning income in the U.S. encourages companies, first of all, to locate production where taxes are lower, but also to move profits without actually moving the location of production to Ireland or other countries where taxes are lower. And it's particularly hard to stop that from happening when you have multinational companies that have operations around the globe and are using intellectual property in production. The attempt to tax based on U.S. corporate residence puts U.S. companies at a disadvantage and also encourages them to keep earnings offshore, because the offshore earnings they'd be taxed on in the U.S. are only taxed if they bring the money home. And they're also encouraged to try to find some way not to be a U.S. company, and hence the rash of corporate inversions that we've seen in a couple of ways in the last couple of waves in the last couple of decades. So we've got profit shifting of actual economic activities to other countries, corporate inversions, the so-called lockout effect that keeps earnings offshore, and what do we do? I think these factors led to what has generally been a bipartisan support for corporate tax reform in the U.S., certainly within the last decade. And there's been agreement. Mark said that the White House and Congress agree on cutting the corporate tax rate, or cutting tax rates. There's been broader agreement on the corporate side, that is, a broader agreement between Democrats and Republicans over the last several years that corporate tax reform is warranted. But again, it's hard to determine what that should be. Mm-hmm. So you could think about what the options might be. The simplest option would be to reduce the corporate tax rate, because all of the problems that I've identified are driven by that. If the corporate tax rate were very low, all these other problems would be a lot less significant. Of course, if you want to reduce the corporate tax rate, you have a choice of either losing revenue which so far has not been something that was acceptable. Or you have to come up with ways of raising revenue or cutting spending or doing something else to pay for the reduction in the corporate tax rate. And there's been absolutely no agreement what to do. And so simply cutting the corporate tax rate and keeping the traditional system the way it is you know, it certainly could happen, but it hasn't happened so far. Then there have been attempts to try to move more in the direction, one direction or another, relying more on residents and less on source, or more, that was an approach that the Obama administration took, or relying more on source and less on residents, which was an approach that Republicans in Congress took a few years ago. And both of those approaches are rather unsatisfactory too, because they make some problems worse and alleviate others. And in general, didn't cause very much excitement. And so what else can you do? Well, I would say it's a good bet that the outcome this year will be that nothing happens. That's, of course, you said a month we're going to see the tax bill. I assume that's a prediction that the healthcare reform is just going to sail right through Congress. because they are in sequence. You know, things may happen along the way that keep anything from happening. But if something does happen, it might take the form of the proposal in the House Republican blueprint that was introduced in June. Now, I saw that when it was introduced as being more of an aspirational document. It was released during a presidential campaign when the smart money had a divided government resulting in November. And so, you know, I thought they were putting out a reform proposal that they thought was a good idea, didn't necessarily think would happen right away, but were trying to provoke discussion. And in that sense, it was, I thought, a good document. Well, the, you know, as they say, the dog caught the bus in November. And now we're, you know, moving full speed ahead with an actual laying out and fleshing out of what that tax reform would be. And on the corporate side, it would be a shift to a destination-based cash flow tax, which has two important components. The one that gets most of the attention is the border adjustment, which I'll get back to. But there are actually pretty important domestic provisions as well. Elimination of interest deductions for non-financial companies, immediate expensing of all capital expenditures, even very long-lived capital. These, in a normal year, these would be considered pretty major proposed changes in the corporate tax system, and actually business tax system, because it would apply to all businesses. The border adjustment, which would could be described in different ways, but effectively tax imports at 20%, which is the corporate tax rate, and subsidize exports at the same rate, would shift the tax system from a taxing based on where profits are generated to where products are sold. And it would have been a very clever idea to introduce a border adjustment, and a very innovative one, except one needs to recognize that border adjustments in this proposal were basically just lifted from the value-added taxes that exist everywhere else in the world. That's exactly what they have. And just as they are intended in those contexts to tax domestic consumption and rather than domestic production, that's effectively what the destination-based cash flow tax would do as well. It has, as I've thought about it over the years, it has many advantages to deal with the problems that I've identified. The problems with corporate residents go and the lockout effect go away because earnings offshore are no longer being taxed. The problems with shifting earnings out of the country go away because related party transactions across borders are no longer have any effect on the U.S. tax liability. And the incentive to move production to lower tax countries goes away because the U.S. is no longer taxing based on production being located in the U.S. It's as if we got rid of our corporate tax entirely for that purpose. And so I think it would deal effectively with all the major problems of the corporate tax that we have. Politically, it has something going for it, which is that over the 10-year budget period that's being considered, it generates a lot of revenue through the trade deficits that the U.S. is running, because border adjustments, increased taxes on imports, lower taxes on exports, we have more imports than exports, and the number, at least by unofficial estimates, is in the area of $1.2, $1.3 trillion over 10 years. And that's real money when you think that the corporate tax itself is raising a few hundred billion dollars a year. It's not a huge source of revenue in the U.S. So that's the justification for the proposal. There are lots of complications. The smoothest transition to such a new system would happen with a sharp exchange rate adjustment. The transition would happen anyway, when all is said and done, but the economic adjustment would be fastest if there's a strong exchange rate response, which basically keeps exports and imports in roughly the same balance as they would have to start with. There are big changes that I mentioned that have gotten too little attention in the public discussion, like the removal of the interest deduction, and that certainly would affect many businesses. And I think the biggest challenge this proposal has, at least judging by the public discussion that I've seen so far, is massive misunderstanding of not only of what the effects of the proposal would be, but on what the proposal itself actually is. I think that is in part a problem caused by the speed with which this process is happening. It's very different from the more traditional tax reform process. Mark talked about, it's been many decades since tax reform. In the 1980s, when we passed the Tax Reform Act of 1986, I remember I began working on early, analyzing early versions of it in 1983. And there was a lot of discussion even before 1983 of different plans and different approaches and a lot of thinking about what the effects would be. So far, we've had far less than a year from the introduction of this plan. And of course, at the very beginning, in June, people were quite distracted and weren't thinking about the potential effects of this plan might be. So one might hope that as this is discussed further, that last problem will disappear, or at least will be reduced. But there are still other significant issues to be thought about in thinking about getting from our current system to what I am convinced is a much better system, but through a transition that is not necessarily simple. Thanks.
That's great.
Keith, your turn.
Okay. I think the most important thing to understand about fundamental tax reform is that people mean very different things when they say they're for fundamental tax reform. If you go to a group of people and say, who here is in favor of fundamental tax reform, you'll see a bunch of hands go up, and then try to get them to discuss and see if they agree on what they mean. And you'll find that it'll break down in about 2 minutes. Economists love to do this, right? Economists and tax policy geeks like me love nothing more than to sit down and argue about what the right tax reform is. Members of Congress, it's even harder because the economists are generally just debating what ideas are the smartest ideas or the ones that make the most sense or sort of a well-intentioned policy debate about what's good policy, whereas the members of Congress also have interests. They have home state interests. They have a large employer in their district or in their state, or they have a particular industry or a particular sector which is affected by a particular type of tax reform. And what I found in my experience is that somehow the ideas that those members embrace just happen to be consistent with the interests of the largest employers in their district or in their home state. It's this remarkable confluence how their interests tend to somehow be consistent with the ideas that they choose in the debate. Everybody involved in tax reform points to 1986. 1986 was the year that it all came together. It was this legislative miracle when they got it done. That was 31 years ago. There's a reason why fundamental tax reform hasn't been done in 31 years. It is the most legislatively difficult type of policy change to enact. Enacting tax reform is really hard to do in Congress. If it were easy, we would have done it multiple times over the past 31 years. Okay. Now, the standard political logic is that tax reform is hard because there are all of these very narrow special interests that are able to leverage their political power to block tax reform. And of course, those narrow special interests have nothing to do with me or what I care about. It's, you know, it's some very targeted tax break. And littered throughout the tax code, you can find narrowly targeted provisions that will benefit a firm or a particular set of firms or a very narrowly defined constituency in terms of its industry impact or its geographic impact, and then everybody likes to hold those up. Accelerated depreciation for NASCAR race venues, right, is sort of a, you know, a classic example of this. And those do exist, and they're horrific tax policy, but there are much larger legislative factors that make it hard to enact tax reform. And so what I want to do is I just want to flag for you a few of those sort of fundamental underlying tensions that make it hard to enact a big tax bill. I got six of them. So the first one is you have to have agreement on what you're going to do with aggregate revenues. Is the total tax take of the federal government going to go up? Is it going to go down? Or is it going to be a zero? Now, usually, when you are trying to design an intellectually honest tax reform, you say zero, right? The sort of, how would we broaden the base, lower the rates, and collect the same amount of revenue for the federal government? But that's a value choice when you're actually enacting a policy. You could combine this with something which is a $500 billion net revenue loss over 10 years, or $1 trillion net revenue loss, or $200 trillion. You can measure these things in percent of GDP. You could say we've historically collected 17.3% of GDP in federal taxes. I think that's too high. My Democrat friends would say it should go up by 2 or 3 percentage points. We have a debate about that, and then we're deciding what our revenue goal is for tax reform. There's a new dimension in this debate, new to a couple years ago, which is the way that tax legislation is being scored now incorporates dynamic analysis, the dynamic effects on GDP. If you do certain large, broad-based cuts in tax rates on capital and labor income, the logic is that you should get credit for the additional supply of capital and labor that will be there and the higher GDP. Tax cuts do not pay for themselves, but good tax policy can partially offset the revenue loss. Partially pay for itself, and that will change the amount of taxes that you can cut and what you mean by zero. Candidate Donald Trump put forward a tax plan which some people were estimating would lose $1 trillion of revenue a year, $10 trillion over a decade. Okay, that's way outside the bounds of even what the most aggressive tax cutters on Capitol Hill had been talking about. The Hill Republicans had been looking at doing something that was revenue neutral, but including the dynamic effects on the economy. The first question is, what's your aggregate revenue goal? And indeed, because of the way the budget process works, that's the first actual decision that they have to legislate in something called the budget resolution, which they'll be dealing with in March and April. Now, closely interacting with that aggregate revenue question is the strategic legislative question, is this going to be partisan or are you going to try for bipartisanship? If you're only going to try and do this with Republican votes, then your upper bound on revenue is zero, dynamically scored, because you're not going to find Republicans who are saying, I want tax reform to increase the federal government's total tax take, down to some big revenue loss. That's your sort of bid at ask on the intramural negotiation and discussion among House and Senate Republicans in the White House. If you're going to try to make this bipartisan, if you're going to try and bring some faction, some subset of the Democratic Party on board, then your bid changes, one side of this changes, because your moderate Democrats are generally going to be saying, at most, I want this to be revenue neutral, and in fact, I would like this to raise some net revenues. So that initial decision you make about the aggregate revenue effect is inextricably tied in with the strategic game plan, and your strategic game plan legislatively looks fundamentally different if you're saying we're trying to get 218 out of 247 Republican votes and 50 out of 54 Republican votes in the Senate, or if you're saying, let's see if we can expand the pie to include half a dozen Democrats maybe, so that we're working with 50 votes out of 60, but it makes your job harder in terms of revenues. Now, the other thing about aggregate revenues is that the more moderate you are as a Republican or your fiscally conservative Democrats who you might want to try to bring on board will generally not want big tax cuts. They'll want revenue neutral or a small net revenue loss or even revenue increasing. So that's the price of getting the center to the moderate left on board, at least with the concept of let's put together a tax reform. But the trick is to get to those numbers and to have deep cuts in rates, you've got to eliminate a lot of tax preferences or scale them back. And that causes policy pain, which causes political pain. So to get the center of the policy spectrum or the center left of the policy spectrum, the demand is, I don't want to have big net tax cuts. When you get into the details of trying to get people to vote for the tax bill, the more pain is in the bill by eliminating or radically scaling back tax preferences, the harder it is to get votes on individual provisions. Okay. Second is the other one that the papers all pay attention to, which is vertical distribution, vertical equity questions. How progressive should our tax code be? What should the distribution of the tax burden be? The top marginal rates versus the bottom marginal rates, going all the way down to the effects on earned income tax credit. And this is a standard left-right debate, right? The more conservative you are on the economic spectrum, the closer you are to arguing for something like a single flat rate. The farther left you move on the spectrum, the more you are likely arguing for a greater distinction between the top and bottom marginal rates. That's a fairly straightforward set of questions. And there's a lot of attention that's paid to that. Okay, third, the money is not in accelerated depreciation for NASCAR tracks. The money in the tax preferences, especially on the individual side, is in five or six provisions which are very broad-based, very popular, very widely used, and very bipartisan. It's the deductibility of charitable contributions. It's home mortgage interest. It's the question of what is your capital taxation rate, which then we get into a debate as to whether that's a tax preference or not, but it is in one view of the world, that is viewed as a tax preference, and there are a lot of people who take advantage of it. It is the treatment of life insurance. It is the exclusion for employer-provided health insurance. These are provisions that lots and lots of taxpayers and voters take advantage of, and there is bipartisan consensus that, oh gosh, we don't want to go after those things because we'll all get killed by the voters. And so the problem is that if you want to cut tax rates a lot and you have some binding revenue constraint, you can't raise the revenue unless you're willing to tackle some of these broadly popular, bipartisan supported tax preferences. Okay? So don't pay attention to the race car tracks unless you're just looking to get fired up. If you're looking to actually do the arithmetic, it's which of the big five or six are we willing to take on? By the way, if you say we're going to eliminate all of them, it'll be the United Way and the nuns or the priests or the rabbis from your local religious institution who will be the first ones into your office who will say, we'd like to, you know, we haven't seen you in church recently and we'd like to talk to you about what you're doing to our religious institution. Right? And then you have the United Way will come in, or they'll come in with the little kids, and UNICEF with the trick-or-treat thing, and the political pressure on the charitable contributions, no member is going to take that on, which is why you will see in the tax plans, almost every member says, we absolutely needed to go to a flat tax code, well, except for charitable. And then you say, okay, what about home mortgage interest? And go, oh, well, maybe not home mortgage interest, and now you're on the slippery slope. Okay, fourth are the member items. These are the narrower provisions, but it's not just narrow interest-based provisions. There are also policy changes that a subset of members really care about. adoption. There's a tax credit in the code for families who adopt kids. If you are in Congress, if adoption is a very important aspect of society to you, and you are looking to have tax policy be adoption friendly, then the adoption tax credit is one way to make government policy amenable to adoption. Now, if you're a tax policy person or an economist, you say it's a tax preference, it's distorting behavior, we should eliminate all tax preferences. If you're an adoption policy person working on adoption policy, your view is, I want to look at spending policies, regulatory policies, tax policies, the whole universe of policies that I can to achieve my particular policy goal. So it depends on what kind of policy experts you're talking to, whether or not they view tax policy as a legitimate tool to pursue a non-tax policy or non-sort of broad-based economic growth goal, right? Everybody, every tax policy and economics person says we shouldn't be giving education tax breaks and healthcare tax breaks. Talk to a bunch of health tax people and say, well, obviously we need to have either a deduction or a credit for tax for the purchase of health insurance. And the education people say, obviously we want tax incentives to encourage people to be able to afford college or save for college or whatever it happens to be. And then international, which is, as Alan was getting at, international is suddenly an increased focus of the debate. There has been a long-standing philosophical debate, which again is sort of a left-right thing, as to whether our tax code needs to move more in a territorial direction or more in a worldwide direction. That's not a new debate. The new, what's politically labeled as border adjustable tax, is sort of a new dimension to that, and Speaker Paul Ryan, sort of the champion of that, I think is largely responsible for that being so prominent. Now Kevin Brady, the Ways and Means Chairman, taking it. But that debate is not a new one, and it's also hard to resolve. Okay, the current environment. They're working on healthcare first. The Trump administration is not fully staffed up. So they have one tax policy expert right now working for Gary Cohn on the NEC, and she's excellent. But Secretary Mnuchin doesn't have an assistant secretary for tax policy. You don't have the retinue of tax policy experts within the administration that the president needs. And at least so far, it appears that the initiative and the policy expertise is largely concentrated on the Hill, starting with House Republicans, and eventually it'll move over to Senate Republicans. In terms of probabilities, it hasn't been done in 30 years, so you always got to start off really skeptical. Your default assumption needs to be, no, they're not going to get it done. But we now have a Republican House, a Republican Senate, a Republican president who all say they want to get tax reform done, and you got to give them a lot of credit for that. But you have a new administration without a lot of legislative expertise or substantive expertise, and they're trying to do something that is incredibly difficult right after trying to do something else that's incredibly difficult. So they're going to try. It appears they're not going to have an opportunity to work with Democrats, which means they're looking at a narrower universe, legislative universe, and then depending on who you talk to as to whose fault it is that there isn't that opportunity for bipartisanship. But they're definitely going to try. I just can't ever bet in favor of tax reform getting done because it's so hard to do. So I'm sorry if I'm being paid to be optimistic here, but it's a struggle with tax reform.
Yes. Well, look, that's a terrific start on both of these two topics. Thank you both, Alan and Keith. So let's shift back to the corporate reform side of the house. And let's see if we can't drill down just a little bit and maybe clarify a few things that seem to be either not fully reported on the press or reported on in ways that don't quite seem to be consistent with some of the theory and framework that Alan outlines. Let's just start with the case of the Boeing company. So we all think of the Boeing company as the poster child who would be facing the prospects of an enormous fraction of its income not being taxable in a world in which export income is tax exempt, and imports are non-deductible. All of a sudden, Boeing goes from a huge taxpayer to a non-taxpayer with lots and lots and lots of excess losses. So will Boeing be a big winner here, Alan?
Well, first of all, the industry groups that have been lining up on this proposal are largely, not exclusively, but largely defined by whether they're exporters or importers, which suggests that that people haven't been convinced that exchange rates will adjust to largely offset border adjustments in terms of their effects on competitiveness of domestic producers and costs of imports. So Boeing would be certainly a big winner in terms of tax reduction. The theory, anyway, is not so much in terms of the bottom line, because if they're selling, if they're facing the headwind of a higher dollar, that should largely offset the benefits they get from a border adjustment. But there's a separate question, leaving that aside, that is whether Boeing should be considered a big winner, which is that the tax system doesn't allow companies to deduct, get a refund for losses. They're required to carry losses forward until such time as they have positive income. And the House plan actually improves on that a little bit by paying interest on the taxes that are carried forward so that companies aren't adversely affected by getting the refund a year later to the extent that they have losses and now in income then. The problem is that unlike companies that maybe experience losses because of a downturn in the business cycle, and we think, well, those go away after a couple of years, they resume profitability. A company like Boeing, with its domestic production and large share of its sales being foreign, could be very profitable in an underlying sense and still not paying any taxes and having basically border adjustment credits that it can't use. And that would be that would make the system not work the way it's designed to work. That is, border adjustments need to actually be received for the system to work. They are received under VATs around the world. You know, if you're a seller and you export something, you get a refund of VAT. And they don't really ask whether what your tax situation is. This is a little bit more complicated because it's in the context of a corporate income tax. And it would be politically very difficult for the government to be writing large checks to Boeing, not to mention Caterpillar. Yeah. So what do you do instead? Well, one answer is companies merge, or an exporter finds an importer. Boeing merges with Walmart, and just a natural merger, right? I mean, that just. You know, it's on everybody's lips, that combination. Same corporate culture, same product space, everything. That of course, that's a costly thing. One would hope that there'd be simpler ways of doing it, setting up an oil importing business or some other ways. It would be nice if there were a simpler way through the way the provisions are designed by the legislation to make it possible for credits to be received, perhaps by allowing transfers to companies that the exporters are dealing with. But it's an issue that needs to be resolved. It's technically not a hard problem to resolve, unlike some of the other issues. But politically, it is not a simple thing to deal with.
So just to go one step further, often there's a challenge in the macroeconomic perspective that's often adopted in tax reform proposals. And oftentimes it's difficult to predict what the microeconomic responses will be to any particular tax law change. So I think Alan very aptly teed up the issue of, Boeing suddenly becomes potentially a massive net operating loss company, and even if the government were to put into place an ability to use those net operating losses plus an interest ticker, if they're forever a structurally net operating loss company, they actually never get any of the rebate, which is what Alan said. So now they don't actually have to merge with the Walmarts of the world in order to effectively, well, I mean, why would they merge with the Walmarts of the world? The reason they would merge with the Walmarts of the world is the flip side to what Alan just said, which is Walmart, as a major importer, wants to avoid the non-deductibility of its imports. Well, if you merged with a net operating loss company, then basically the lack of deductions that Boeing would experience wouldn't really cost them anything, because they generate excess tax losses anyway. And consequently, it doesn't actually impose the kind of the targeted effect on the import side. But you could even do it, as Alan points out, it would be difficult to, there are big frictional costs associated with the sort of merger that Alan was just talking about. But what about simply setting up value-added resale arrangements where, you know, Walmart, dealing with its non-deductibility of imports, simply purchases from a domestic firm that imports the very goods that Walmart would have, that generates excess losses for any either of two reasons, both of which Alan touched on earlier. One, being an export firm, you just generally have no income but lots of deductions. Or second, Alan made mention of the fact that part of the tax proposal includes a provision to have immediate deductibility of all capital expenditures, which would create a very large number of brand new net operating loss companies just like Boeing. And so with all these excess losses in the system, any one of them, of those firms, would find it in their best interest to create a new unit in the United States to do all the importing for the Walmarts of the world and resell those goods to Walmart, because they wouldn't mind the loss of deduction. Or said differently, the income that they earn on the resale agreement would be tax exempt because of all the net operating losses they generate, and essentially allow Walmart to get the tax deduction on imports. These are the microeconomic challenges associated with any sort of tax law changes. So I guess the question is, some of the revenue forecasts that we have seen from the passage of a border-adjusted tax is sort of on the order of $120 billion a year. And the rough math goes, and it's not nearly as sophisticated as the underlying models are, but the rough math goes, well, you know, the U.S. has a trade deficit of $600 billion. There's roughly a 20% tax collection resulting from the non-deductibility of imports, and a rough 20% loss from the exemption of exports. But if there are more imports than exports by $600 billion, then you got, you know, you got another $120 billion of revenue every year that helps to pay for other aspects of the reform. The question is, if you have recontracting in the way that I just described, whether those are still approximately good estimates, whether they actually fall into the category of be careful what you wish for because you might get it because you actually may generate negative tax revenues from. Where does that sort of all land, Alan, do you think?
Well, what I don't know is the extent to which there is no official revenue estimate for this proposal, but groups like the Tax Policy Center in Washington have estimated numbers like $1.2 trillion over 10 years. I've kind of been assuming that they're making some assumption about border adjustments not being completely usable for exporters. And so to the extent that they would engage in transactions like this, that would reduce the revenue estimate. It's still going to be a big number, though, because we do have a trade deficit. And so, you know, if you just multiply it by the trade deficit, you're assuming that the border adjustments are fully usable. I think in the end, however it's scored, the numbers may vary, but I think this will still be, at least in the short run, over a 10-year period, will be an important component of the proposal because it will be found to raise revenue, or at least estimated to raise revenue.
Yeah, good. So, Keith, why don't we switch over to you for a bit? So, where do you think the congressional Republicans are heading on tax reform, and how does it differ from where Trump is heading?
Oh, is that all? I have no idea, and so I'll guess that. So my starting point is the Brady Plan.
Next question.
Yeah. My starting point is the Brady Plan, and because that is the most. First of all, because tax legislation starts in the House. Formally, it has to, but realistically, it always does. Second is because the Brady Plan has been out there for a couple years. And it is the chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee. So that is clearly going to be the starting point of discussion until and unless President Trump proposes his own alternative, and then that will become the starting point for discussion. So the most important question is, will President Trump propose his own comprehensive tax reform plan? And without any inside knowledge, my guess is probably not. Because I'm looking at healthcare as the model, where so far what the Trump administration has done is allowed House Republicans to take the lead in defining how they want to do it, and then he and his team comment on things that they like and things that they don't like to incrementally nudge the legislation in a direction that they care about on issues that are important to them. My guess is that when we get to trade, President Trump will be very comprehensive in terms of what he wants to do because he clearly cares a lot about the details of that. So far on border adjustability, we've seen mixed signals coming out of the Trump administration, and I take that as at least an initial indication that so far at least they have decided not to weigh in heavily on one side or another. Might he at some point? Sure. But I know of no reason to think that that behavior would necessarily change because I've seen no indication that he has a strong policy preference or that there's an obvious political or legislative reason for him to weigh in. Why not allow Kevin Brady and Paul Ryan and Kevin McCarthy to run with the ball and then weigh in incrementally as things move forward? Mm-hmm. On any question, I'll basically say, here's what the Brady Plan does. It's aspirational. And, you know, maybe they'll get partway there.
So given the given all the messiness that you so aptly described and challenges associated with wrestling this whole process to a successful conclusion, what do you think the likelihood is that, given the importance that Ryan clearly has placed on getting something passed, what do you think the likelihood is that there's kind of a two-stage process here with, you know, maybe the first stage of the process being relatively vanilla tax rate reductions of probably more modest magnitude than has been proposed because otherwise it has too big a revenue implication, followed by a longer debate that, you know, kind of maybe the first version happening in 2017 and the longer version, we fight hard at trying to do reform where the debate, you know, kind of goes into 2018, and we do the best we can. What do you think's likely?
I think slim to no chances of a two-stage process leading to two laws being enacted.
Mm-hmm.
I instead think of it this way, which is I think there are three possible outcomes. One is no legislation is enacted, and I look on sort of the first 2 years as the sweet spot for this. Mm-hmm. It's not getting signed by August recess. I don't care what anyone says. But I see the first 2 years as the sweet spot. And I see, you know, either they get nothing done during those 2 years. Maybe they can get something that Al and I would look at and say, that looks like a fundamental tax reform. I think there is a higher likelihood that they can't get there on something that we might call as fundamental tax reform, and instead they're doing incremental rate reductions that I would more traditionally label as tax cuts rather than sort of broadening the base and lowering the rates and more approaching revenue neutrality. Mm-hmm. I think that if they instead, I think that the incremental tax cuts are a fallback if you believe that you're not going to get fundamental reform done.
Mm-hmm.
And I think You don't move to that fallback until and unless you are certain that you're not going to be able to achieve your principal goal of fundamental reform. And so no legislator is going to say that they're interested in doing that. They're going to keep pushing and keep pushing and keep pushing. Because I think they are correct in their assessment that if they were to enact incremental tax rate cuts, they would take all of the legislative steam away from the effort to do something bigger and broader and harder.
Yeah, good answer. You know what? Why don't we open it up to questioning? And I knew my first question was going to come from my favorite Pitch Johnson. So fire away. Yeah, microphone for a second, please.
At a macro level, you touched on this, Keith, by mentioning the word dynamics, but there's an argument that lower taxes will increase economic growth rate, and new tax rate, even the lower tax rates on a bigger economy, will pay for themselves. So what is the economic reality of that argument, and what is the political reality of that argument?
So Alan obviously will feel free to disagree with me. I think that the claim in its strong form that there will be so much additional economic growth created that the tax revenues, the marginal tax revenues collections on that additional economic growth will offset the initial revenue loss is absurd. It's false.
It's laugherable.
Right? It's the direction is correct, but the that doesn't mean that they won't like it, right? But if your GDP effect, so the dynamic effect is offsetting 10%, 20%, a third, and then you have a debate among smart economists as to whether the revenue effect is a 10% dynamic effect or a 33% dynamic effect, I'm not going to believe anyone who's going to say that it's 100% effect.
John Taylor actually gave a talk on a number of deregulatory topics last night, and he specifically estimated that the answer to your question, Pitch, was perhaps as much as 20% of the tax reduction would be recovered through productivity effects.
One additional comment on this. I think that Republican legislators have harmed themselves in terms of their intellectual credibility by going to the stronger claim of 100%, because you can't find economists to back that up. And if they were instead to not say they're going to pay for themselves, but it'll partially offset the revenue loss if we do tax reform right, I think they'd be on much more solid ground.
Dixon.
Simple question. Are there any obvious low-hanging fruits that people could get done quickly, and such as the changing of the corporate rate for repatriation of all the dollars that are stashed offshore?
What do you think?
In 2004, we had a repatriation tax holiday where we had a one-time only, reduction in the corporate tax rate on repatriated, permanently reinvested earnings. And it generated a huge amount of repatriations. Since then, U.S. corporations have accumulated at a much more rapid pace earnings offshore. Hard to understand since that was a one-time holiday. The estimates now by the Joint Committee on Taxation are that over a 10-year period, a repatriation tax holiday would lose federal revenue because of the announcement effects. And therefore, it may happen. It has bipartisan support. On the other hand, it can't be used as a cash cow for rate cuts or anything like that. At least not by official scoring.
And it won't happen, nor would any other of the few low-hanging fruit that might exist out there, as long as the big kahuna of fundamental tax reform remains a legislative possibility in the minds of legislative leaders in the present.
Henry Aaron.
An observation and a question. The observation is that base broadening tax reform dynamic effect could lower revenue rather than raise them. The Congressional Budget Office looked fairly carefully at this several years back, concluded that there were effects that went in both directions, and that the net effects were, in general, small plus or minus, depending on the model and the assumptions one made. My real question is for Alan, and this is something I'm puzzled about. The border adjustment basic neutrality argument hinges on exchange rate adjustments offsetting the tax. I'm basing this question actually after having read an article you wrote, which I thought was excellent, reviewing a large list of objections to the tax. And this was a question I didn't see answered thoroughly. I think it's well established that exchange rates depend at least as much on capital movements as on trade. All of the discussion so far has focused on trade. Capital movements depend on a whole host of factors. No model adequately, in my view, encapsulates them and gives a reliable estimate of what, when you introduce a shock, the effect on capital movements will be. So the question I have is, are you confident that exchange rate adjustments will offset the effects of the tax? And if, as I think your answer will probably be, no, I'm not, how sensitive is the viability and desirability of the reform you're proposing dependent on that assumption?
First of all, let me say that the viability of the proposal doesn't depend on an immediate and perfect exchange rate adjustment. That makes it smoother, but a reaction through domestic wages and prices, I mean, in technical terms, what one expects to see and what the evidence suggests will happen is a real exchange rate reaction. And the real exchange rate can happen either through domestic wages and prices going up or through the nominal exchange rate. The benefit of a nominal exchange rate reaction is exchange rates react really quickly because capital flows are so important in determining the exchange rate. You don't have to wait for trade flows to adjust for the exchange rate to jump. Whereas if the exchange rate were more sluggish in its movement, there would be factors pushing domestic wages and prices up, and in a world in which wages and prices don't react as quickly as exchange rates, there would be a period of adjustment. So it doesn't need it to work. Putting it another way, if you look around the world at countries that have value-added taxes with border adjustments as high as 20%, like some European countries, they don't have patterns of production that look a lot different from countries like the U.S. that don't have value-added taxes and border adjustments. So there can't really be any, when the adjustment process is done, there can't be any obvious impact simply having to do with import the role of imports or exports in a particular industry's activity. That doesn't mean that the speed of the adjustment process will be the same regardless of whether the exchange rate jump happens immediately. As to the question of whether the exchange rate jump will happen immediately, my purpose in writing that piece, which I think we may be just available here at the end of the session, no royalties. I won't get any royalties on it.
I think I see a pile of papers at the far end of it. And by the way, it's a terrific piece, so pick up a copy on the way out.
The purpose in writing that piece was not to make the argument that the exact offset to border adjustments would occur with certainty, but more to make the argument that that is a plausible place to start before one considers the various complications. And the various complications, some of which I think are spurious, which was the point of writing that also, but others of which are, I think, really may matter, is that, yes, there could be less than full dollar appreciation. There could also be more than a full dollar appreciation. There's a confidence interval around it, which is not tight. But I think it's important to say that if there's a significant border exchange rate response that's not exactly offsetting, the other adjustment parts of, you know, a mechanism for adjustments is still there, and we'll have to do a lot less of the work because the exchange rate is adjusted. So that's one of the reasons why I'm optimistic about the what the economic effects of the proposal would be.
So, by the way, with the March Madness betting season upon us, don't bet your friends on whether the exchange rate will experience the full adjustment that we've been debating a little bit indirectly here this afternoon, because we may have already seen some of it anticipated with the potential future passage of the bill, so we'll never know the answer to the question fully, although I guarantee you all the folks predicting less than full exchange rate adjustments will take credit for the accuracy of their forecast, notwithstanding the fact that some of the adjustments have already taken place. Greg Rostin. Oh, you were telling me 5 minutes.
Following up on the whether there's going to be full adjustment or not, like you suggested, every theory is wrong, some are useful. And I understand that there's really a lack of empirical evidence that suggests that this is going to work. If it is delayed and it's not adjusted fully, isn't this going to be a very regressive tax in the sense that lower income families are dependent on a lot of cheap imported goods?
Steve, so if the exchange rate, say, adjusts two-thirds of the way in the first year, and the rest of the adjustment happens through combination of further exchange rate adjustments over the next couple of years and some increase in domestic wages and prices, after the two-year period, the economy will look the way it would have looked right away. So when you say regressive, you're saying regressive for a year, not in the long run. So I think in terms of saleability, that's an issue. You know, if the prices at Walmart go up in the first year by a little bit, And it takes another year for wages to go up in response to that, and people don't make the connection between the wage increases and the price increases. And if the initial price increases cause the Fed to raise interest rates, which further causes the exchange rate to go up, so all that adjustment happens still pretty quickly, that does increase the economic costs of making the adjustment, but we're still talking about a short period of time and a very long period of benefit.
Well, I love the fact that there are still so many people who would like to ask follow-on questions. And I know you're particularly interested in knowing what's in the crystal ball we have up here with respect to whether the estate tax is going to be repealed. But unfortunately, we've run out of time. And we have time for a couple more questions? Okay, I've been overruled. Pete. Blasting. Halvarian, wonderful.
Yes. So suppose the exchange rate does adjustment as you described, then there's going to be a big impact on asset markets with respect to dollar-denominated and non-dollar-denominated assets, which could potentially be somewhat disruptive.
So I have an estimate. I've done I would say more than a back of the envelope estimate of the loss in value of assets held offshore by U.S. individuals and corporations. One can't come to an exact estimate because it involves knowing indirect ownership by foreigners of U.S. companies and things like that. But it's probably between $1 and $2 trillion. That's actually, you know, it sounds like a big number. It sounds like a big number, but if you look at the Fed's balance sheets and see how much U.S. assets are, it's big, but it's not big relative to the total of U.S. assets. If one wants to think about the implications, it has macroeconomic implications, probably small. It has, in terms of sort of market predictions, it would certainly make you think about, if you're thinking about what happens to the relative valuation of different companies with very large offshore positions would obviously fare worse because of that than other companies, other things being equal. It's one of the many potential effects. I don't see it as particularly disruptive. I guess the one disruptive element that people have talked about is the risk of sovereign, particularly sovereign borrowers and countries with less stable currencies that have borrowed in dollars. And I guess there are a couple of potential answers to that. One is, what have they been doing in the last few months? You know, the dollar's appreciated. We haven't had, it hasn't sparked a worldwide recession. There are also measures that they can take, knowing that there's some possibility that this further dollar appreciation might happen in terms of hedging currency risk and so forth. Now, you know, you might say, well, gosh, these guys don't know how to manage their own currency. How do they know how to hedge? and that's that may be a real problem. But I think, you know, there's a worst case scenario for that, but I don't think that's a very likely outcome.
By the way, I did notice a few of my private equity friends in the audience squirm when Alan made reference to the fact that interest may be non-deductible under this next tax bill. I would only advise you to prepare yourselves to redo your capital structures, replacing debt with preferred stock, and we don't quite have time to go into why that mitigates significantly the consequences of loss of interest deductibility, but it does. So, last question, Pete Blaustein.
So this is a question for Alan. So given the political difficulties from, say, Walmart, would a border tax adjustment work if, say, you limited only to capital goods, say, over $10,000? The benefits to this, I could see, for example, are that the political benefits, and second, you'd avoid onshoring low productivity jobs, is a point actually Mark's made, where we don't actually want to bring factories to make low-priced goods anyway. Is that something that could work, and do you see any benefits to that?
Let me just make sure I understand your suggestion. When you say limit it to capital goods, you mean have the border adjustments only apply to capital goods?
Border tax adjustment only to goods over, say, $10,000, something like that.
I would need to think through the ramifications of that, but my first reaction is it's probably going to lead to some complicated distortions. Mm-hmm. And not all of which I can think of in the next 15 seconds.
I think if you would please join me in thanking our panel, Alan, fantastic job. Cocktails will be served.
Are you rechecking for dinner?
Oh, yeah.
Are you rechecking for dinner?
Great job.
Yeah, good job, Mark.
Thank you.